their parameter values. And the lower bound we have is that the risk is bounded by this distance S over 4 times this affinity. And as I pointed out, this can be difficult to compute. So another bound that's useful is to replace that with S over 8 e to the minus n. And this is just the Kolbach-Leibler distance between P0 and P1. And the trick here is to try to make sure this term doesn't go to 0. We want to keep the risk bounded away from 0 to get a good lower bound. So if we set this to be like 1 over n, I picked here log 2 over n, and plug it in, then this becomes like a half. And so you're done. You pick two distributions that satisfy this condition. You compute the distance between their parameter values, s, and you have a lower bound for the risk. So that's Lacombe's method. It's almost close to being kind of like an algorithm. Just find two distributions that are close in Kolbach-Leibler distance. The example we were doing was at example 8, the bottom of page 6, which was our familiar example where we were doing non-parametric regression. With normal errors, or at least the set of distributions has to contain within it that epsilon is normal. And satisfying the usual Lipschitz constraint. And we were just finishing the construction, which was to pick two distributions. So the joint distribution for x and y. Hey, look who's back. All right. Welcome back, Ryan. And we took p0 of x and p y given x this way. So p0 of x we'll take to be uniform on 0, 1. And y given x is normal. So that's normal density y minus m of x. And so picking two distributions for Lacombe's method comes down to picking two different convenient regression functions. And the ones we picked, remember, were just take the one that's 0 everywhere. And then we take a perturbed version. This is always how you do these minimax arguments. So we'll take a little perturbation up to some point epsilon yet to be determined. And I picked this point here to be L epsilon. So that's just a piecewise linear function. The difference, what is S? S is the difference between, remember that the loss function we're considering was just m at 0 minus m hat at 0. We just pick one point kind of arbitrarily. And the s is what? It's the distance between the two parameter values, which is the regression function at 0. So for this one, it's 0. For this one, it's L epsilon. So s is L epsilon. And there's this free parameter here, which is how big do I make this perturbation? And so the last thing we have to do is compute the KL distance between these two densities. And then set, that will tell us how to pick epsilon, because we want to satisfy this condition that the KL distance is of order 1 over n. So the calculation is done here on page 7. The KL distance, let's remind ourselves what that is. So it's since the nice thing about these lower bounds, remember, we get to pick the distributions. And so you try to pick them so these calculations are pretty easy. So I picked remember, we can write these as p0 of x times py given x, right? And p0 of x and p1 of x are both taken to be uniform. So this really becomes x actually writes this is. This p0 of x is phi of y. But I'm taking this to be 0, right? So that's just a normal density. So that really makes it easy. This is just phi of y log phi of y, and this is phi of y minus actually, I should write it the other way. But for, you know, the inner integral fixed over y, and so for a fixed y, what is that? That's just the KL distance between two normal distributions. Think of x as fixed. We're doing the inner integral. X is fixed. So this is just what's the distance between a normal 0, 1, and what's the distance between a normal with mean m1 of x and 1? Well, you can, I don't know if we've done this before, but you know, you can write down the KL distance between two normals with the same variance and different means. It's a very easy calculation. You can look it up on Wikipedia or whatever. It's just the difference of the mean squared divided by 2. So this becomes the difference of the mean squared divided by 2. Because m0 is 0, right? In fact, m1 of x is 0 outside of epsilon. So this is really the integral from 0 to 1, 1/2. This is, what was the formula for that? It was L epsilon minus x squared. In other words, we're just taking this distance squared and integrating it. Very simple integral. Turns out to be, when you just do the integral, you get L squared epsilon cubed 6. So we picked everything so that the KL distance could be easily computed. Oftentimes you can't compute it, but you can bound it, which is good enough. We know what we want. We want that to be equal to log 2 over n. So I just have to solve for epsilon to make this to be log 2 over n. So I can use that lemma. And then the answer is, if to do that, you just have to take epsilon to be, let's just say, a constant over n to the 1/3. And that's it. Now we've fulfilled the conditions. We have two functions which define two distributions. Both distributions are in the class. The distance is of order log 2 over n, which means that the Kullback-Leibler distance between these is of order 1 over n, which means we can use that thing and say that therefore a minimax bound on the RISC is S. L we're thinking of here is a constant. So what's the RISC? It's epsilon, which is of order 1 over n to the 1/3. So now, just using Lacombe's method, we've shown a lower bound on estimating the RISC at a point in absolute error is n to the 1/3. Right? Is there any questions about that? I used absolute error. I could have done the whole thing with taking m. I could have done everything in terms of mx minus m of x squared. I didn't have to use absolute error. The only thing that would have happened is at the end you'd end up on the squared scale. So in the L2 loss, this would be 1 over n to the 2/3. The D you put in there doesn't even have to actually be a metric. It just has to satisfy some basic conditions. I did this in one dimension. What if I had done it in D dimensions? It wouldn't be that much different. So here's the two functions I would pick. I would take a constant one, and then I would pick one, you know, a similar thing. Here I can draw it in, you know, one dimension. It's like this. I would do a similar thing here. I would just take it to be constant and then pop up with slope L. You'd now have to do a d-dimensional integral, not a hard integral. It's like, you know, a linear integral over thing. And you would get the same answer, except that you would get d equals 1 being a special case. That's where those numbers come from that we've been throwing at you. How about the upper bound? Remember, you can pick any estimator and compute its maximum risk. Can you think of an estimator for regression? Let's just do the one-dimensional case again. Under the Lipschitz condition, what's an estimator that we might use, a very simple estimator that we might use to estimate the regression function? A constant? That's going to have bad risk. That would give us an upper bound, you're right. It would be constant, so it would be an upper bound, but it wouldn't be tight. But close to that would be a piecewise constant, like a histogram except for regression, a regressogram. Right, you just chop it up into pieces. I don't know if we've actually analyzed that regression estimator, but it's very easy. You can compute the bias and variance the way we've always done. And once you have the bias and the variance, you're done, right? And so you can convince yourself that the upper bound would also be 1 over n to the 1/3. So what we've shown is that the minimax risk, I've been sort of fast and loose with constants here, but there's some constant there. Let's call them C1 and C2. And actually, let me say it in a more familiar, suppose I'd done it with squared error instead of absolute error, just because I think that'll look more familiar. We would have got this. And so what we can say here is now we've nailed the rate. Again, we're not too worried about the constants, but we could write that as the way I wrote it the other day is it's 2/3, or more generally, if we'd done it in d dimensions, 2 over 2 plus d. Yeah?
Especially getting the lower bound, there's just so many approximations or other things. Is that all going to the constant? How can it be tight with all the things we've done?
Hopefully it all shows up in the constant. But you do run into this problem where sometimes you have a lower bound and an upper bound that are going at different rates. And now you have a problem because either your upper bound isn't tight or your lower bound isn't tight. And it may not be obvious sometimes which one. So it may not be easy. Yeah. Jesus is smiling because he's been wrestling with this for a year on a problem where he's got an upper and lower bound. Can't get them to match. So this can vary from trivial to really hard to figure out. You know, hopefully you'll get similar, same rates, and so it won't be an issue. In fact, I don't think if I have this later, but if we had done not Lipschitz, but smoother functions, we're going to actually do an example of smoother functions later, but I'll just tell you, it's exactly the same thing. We'll get to this at the end of the class, but you take a function, you know, like that, and then you take as the alternative some little smooth bump. To make sure you're satisfying the smoothness constraints, we can't use like a thing like that anymore. It has to be a smoother thing. But if you pick a convenient bump, you can. It's just a matter now of, again, computing the KL distance. And you're going to get a slightly different integral. And that's where we keep getting this. We'll show you that later. Later, I just wanted to portend what's coming up. Okay. So hopefully it doesn't seem so mysterious, except for one thing. We really haven't, the rates I just told you were for estimating the regression function at a point. But obviously that's not how we usually evaluate a regression or a density estimator. We usually look at something like this, squared error loss or absolute loss or whatever, something like this, which is not just at a point. So how do we do it for this distance? So this is where Fano's inequality comes in. So the idea is this. When you're doing a loss function like L2 where you're summing up the losses like that, you're integrating the loss, you can't just do one perturbation. You're going to need many perturbations. So what we're going to end up doing is this. We'll take something like our constant function. And now we'll put a little perturbation. That'll be one of our functions. Then we'll consider a function like this. There's another perturbation. Then we'll consider one like this. And then we'll consider one maybe like this, and so on. We'll consider lots of perturbations of the function. And so what that's going to give us, not two guys like in the calm, but a whole set of guys. And that was, remember, the original thing we did is we assumed we were going to pick some finite set of distributions. OK, let me remind you of the very first thing we proved. This was theorem 3. So it's the first thing we proved. I don't know why it's theorem 3, but that's the way it came out, which was that the minimax risk is bigger than or equal to. We said, suppose you pick a finite set of distributions in the class. Compute S now is what? It's the closest pair in terms of loss. So this would be like the smallest. If I had a bunch of regression functions, I'd compute the L2 distance between every one of those regression functions and take the smallest one, S. And what we showed was that this is bigger than or equal to this times this guy. This is our finite set. I called it M. So you remember this? This was saying we reduced the minimax problem to take a finite set, find the closest pair, and this is the probability, the smallest possible probability of error in the problem where I pick one of these distributions, I give you data, and you have to guess which one generated it, then this is the smallest probability of such a guess that you can make, smallest error probability. And when it came down to two distributions, we saw, well, it's just like a simple testing problem, and we got Lacombe's lemma. So now all we need to do is, how do we bound this more generally for k or for how many did I say there are? Capital N guys instead of two guys. Okay? Otherwise, it's exactly the same. And the answer is, the most common answer is what's called Fano's inequality. So what's Fano's inequality? It's actually an inequality from information theory. This is page 8 now. I call it lower bound method 2, Fano's inequality. So it's just a bound on this. Just a generalization of Lacombe. And here's the answer. I'm going to tell you what the answer is. This is lemma 11, page 8. What is the smallest? In this problem where I generate observations from one guy, and you have to guess, what's the small, and you have to, you know, guess as well as you can, what's the smallest you can make the error probability? And the answer is this. Well, at least this is a bound on it. It's 1 minus n beta plus log of 2 over log of n, where beta is now the maximum Kullback-Leibler distance . Okay, so now here's our answer. The minimax risk in general is more, is that we have this is bigger than S over 2 times this. And notice that we've got these two competing things. We're picking this finite set. S is the smallest distance, like say, think of them as regression functions, the two closest regression functions. Beta is the maximum distance, though, between in KL distance. In particular, you know, again, I want to make sure this is kind of bounded, right? If this is going to 1, this would not be a good bound. This would go to 0. So let's say we can bound this by a half or something. As long as I can make sure, look at this, it's the same condition, right? If I can make sure these KL distances are like 1 over n, this is going to keep this sort of like a constant. And then you're going to have this a nice bound here. That's what corollary 13 says, is that if you pick these so that beta is less than log n over 4n. So now we have, again, a 1 over n thing, but the log of the number of probability measures is coming into it. I just chose that to make sure this was less than a half. Then we're done. Then the max risk is bigger than n. So let's just think about this again as kind of like an algorithm. You want to prove a minimax lower bound. You choose a finite set of distributions. conveniently. Maybe they're going to look like this. You compute the pairwise distance between each of these functions and find the smallest. That's your s. Now you compute the KL distance between each pair. Make sure it satisfies this, and you're done. You've now computed the minimax rate. Okay. There's another slightly more refined inequality called Sibikov's bound, which is on the next page. I'm not going to go through that one. I put it there for completeness. It's sometimes more convenient than the difference is that Sibikov's bound does not require the KL, you to do the to bound the KL distance between every pair of distributions. You get to pick one guy, like the center guy, like the constant function, and just compute the KL distances between that and the other ones, which is a little bit more convenient. So Sibikov's bound is sort of a, and I see there's a typo in it too, but anyway, it's a more convenient version of Fanno's inequality is the way to think about it. And I'm not going to prove this bound. How did we get from here to here? We did it for Lacombe. The proof for this is not so much longer, but it's a bit longer, and it's in the appendix in the notes if you want to see it. But hopefully it seems believable because it's so similar to Lacombe's thing. All right, so we're in pretty good shape because now we're going to show, I'm going to show you the L2 error in regression by constructing a whole set of P's. There's just one problem. Okay. So if only it was this easy. There's a slight wrinkle. So suppose, let's forget these negative ones. Let's suppose I consider the regression problem. Let's stick to the Lipschitz one. So I'm going to take, that's going to be my first regression function, and that defines my first probability measure. My second one, let's say I'll take to be like have a little bump in it, like a little Lipschitz bump. The next one is going to have a bump here. The next one is going to have a bump here. So what I'm doing is I'm just partitioning up the line. And for every element of the partition, I add a bump. That defines a new regression function. These are my, so this is my P1 to Pn. However, I'm also going to consider other ones. Like, what if, actually, I shouldn't put that yet, because I also want to consider, well, what if I put two bumps? Or maybe I put these two bumps here, or maybe I put, I want to consider all possible ways of putting these bumps. You need to consider a sufficiently rich class to get the right rate. So let me just show you now why there's a small problem. If you just tried to apply Fanno's inequality directly, you wouldn't get the right rate. Let me show you why. So if I divide this up, let's say into m pieces. And now again, I'm going to construct this set of distributions by deciding in every single bin, do I put a little blip, yes or no? How many such functions are there then? To the m, okay. Now, let's think of each one of those guys as a bit sequence. I can think of, like, you know, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, let's say. And that just says no bump, no bump, 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 no bump, no bump. Okay, and that's like a code for constructing all of these functions. There's just one small problem, which is this. Some of these guys, so remember, where's the bound? We have, I've lost the bound. Well, let me just put it up again. It's, I'll put it. It's s over 2 times that error probability. What's s over 2 now? S over 2 is if I'm going to be computing, let's say, L2 error between regression functions, it'll just be the L2 distance between any pair of these. But it's the smallest such distance. So some of these guys are going to be pretty far apart. So for example, if I put a bump, 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 flat, and that guy here that says flat, bump, 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 they'll be pretty far apart, right? But how about this guy? Bump, bump, no bump. In other words, what if they only differ, say, in like one location? The problem with this is these are going to be really close together. you've sort of screwed things up because you've, by taking all these possible functions, you're going to end up with some pairs that happen to be really close together. Or in other words, if I think about these bit sequences, I might get some that, you know, if I have two sequences of zeros and ones, the sum of the differences is called the Hamming distance. And you're going to get some sequences of zeros and ones that have a small Hamming distance. They only differ, say, in one or two locations. Why? Because we're considering all such binary sequences. Those, you can see, when I take the L2 error, are going to be very small. So here's the question. Can I keep a sufficiently rich set of functions? So we still need a large class of functions, large enough class of functions to make this work, but get rid of ones that are too close together. In other words, what I'm really talking about is these are points on the hypercube. Just think of this as a hypercube, you know, telling you 0, 0, 1, 0, you know, where you are in the hypercube. I'm asking, can you prune the hypercube? Can you take some points from the hypercube so you still have sort of covered the hypercube pretty well, but you don't allow things to get too close together? Okay, and the answer is yes. Okay, the cool thing about this is we started out with 2 to the m guys. It turns out you can construct, I'll call it the pruned hypercube, a subset of these bit sequences that's almost the same size, 2m over 8, but such that you never get any guys that are too close together. In other words, that the Hamming distance, so the Hamming distance, let's call this V and W for any two bit sequences. The Hamming distance, just the number of places where these differ, for any pair in this pruned hypercube is guaranteed to be of size n over 8. So nothing like 1 or 2 or anything like that. I guess I should say m over 8. So in other words, I'm filling in zeros and ones. There's lots of them. But when I compare pairwise, they're never too close together. They're always like a significant fraction of these differ. That's going to force the L2 distance between these to always be sufficiently pretty big. How do you prove that? So this is called the Varshamov-Gilbert theorem. It's at the bottom of page 10. I'm not going to go through the proof, but it works like if you thought about how you would actually construct it, what would you do? You would start with a bunch of, take all sequences. Now I pick one, like let's say this one. Now I just find all the guys that are close in Hamming distance and throw them out. And then continue. Think of it like an algorithm. That actually is constructive in some sense. And the proof just goes through that. What happens if you do that? And it shows that there will exist this many guys left over and they're all far apart. So that's a very cool thing, very handy. And now we're going to use that. Let me put it all together for you. We're going to take a function. We're going to partition up the space. We're going to perform all possible perturbations so that we have this rich set of perturbations. Then we're going to prune it. We're going to hit it with Varshamov-Gilbert and throw away the ones that are pairwise close together. Then we're done. We just compute the distance between each pair and the KL distance and plug it into the bound. And so I'm going to do that for you I'll just walk through. Do I really want to do the calculations? It's very similar to what we just did. This is example 16. And it's just the same example. So I'm doing regression, let's say on the unit interval. I took the class of regression functions here to actually be the generalized Holder class. Let's just say with beta derivatives. Okay? And let me just explain, I won't go through all the details now because you can see basically how it's going to work, but let me just guide you through what you actually do. The calculations are not so bad. So again, we form a bunch of joint distributions. We write them this way, P of y given x, P of x. Let's take x to be uniform and the error distribution to be normal. So these are just a bunch of normals now, once I've specified these functions. And you can see the class of functions there is, I called it fw of x. Omega j is just the bit sequence. Omega j is just 1 or 0 saying, am I perturbing the mth bin or not? So we've divided it up into m bins. Did I call it m? I did, which is bad notation since m is also the regression function. I'm sorry about that. So this is just telling you whether you perturb it or not. And the perturbation function I called phi jx. What do these perturbation functions look like? How do I make sure? So I'm going to start with, say, the constant function. How do I make sure the perturbation is still smooth? Well, that's easy. If you just take basically what looks like a kernel, you take L H to the beta, where H is 1 over the number of bins, times some very smooth kernel. So in other words, I'm just taking a compactly recorded smooth kernel function, and I'm shifting it. Xj is the center of the spin. That's your perturbation. And since it's a sum of smooth functions, it's easy to say that, you know, it satisfies. You have to check this, but you can check that it satisfies whatever the Lipschitz condition or the derivative condition that you've imposed on the class. But now, the set of all such functions, again, would be too big. So we don't let omega vary throughout the hypercube. We let it vary throughout the pruned hypercube, which in the notes I called omega prime. And the set of such functions is called f prime. And then what I've done for you is I've just computed what the distance is. The L2 distance between any two of these functions is basically, if I take two of them, say it looks like this one looks like this, and this one looks like this. Well, it's basically the integral of any one of these things squared times the Hamming distance, how many disagreements. But we've ensured the Hamming distance was bigger than some number, right, n over 8. So without even knowing the details about the kernel function, the integral, I did the integral for you at the bottom. This choice of function, you get that the distance between any two of these guys is bigger than or equal to the square root of the Hamming distance, which was m over 8, actually square root of the Hamming distance, times, it turns out, when you plug this in, you get h to the beta times a constant. I just literally put in the kernel, integrated it. There's a constant there, which is the integral of the kernel squared. It doesn't matter what that is. It's just some. But you see, if I hadn't done that pruning, I wouldn't have the m here. M's going to be growing with n. Too small number. In fact, you know, if you were doing this from scratch, you'd say, well, how many bins do I use? You'd leave that unspecified at first. And you'd have to play around with it to make everything work out. But I can tell you what n is. M is the correct choice. Is this. And then the last thing is just to compute the KL distance for any pair of these. It's, again, because of the form of these things, you just plug it into KL and you bound it. I'm not going to do the calculation. It's very straightforward. It's, again, not worrying about constants. It's h to the 2b. But what do we want? In order, oh, yes. Question. Right, that's exactly it. Otherwise, S would be small. So we would get a bound, but you wouldn't get a tight bound. What do we know? I know that to use that all that jazz I put over there, I need this. Remember, to use the lemma, the corollary, I said I wanted to make the KL distance less than what? Log n over 4n. What's capital N? It's the number of things in our pruned hypercube. It's 2 to the m over 8. So this becomes m log 2 over 32 n. This is what we want. We want this to be true, and then we're done. And then we can just apply a lemma. So that tells me how to pick H. So I now have no choice how to pick H. And the way I know how to pick M, well, H is M. H is 1 over M. That's how I knew to pick M. So what does all this mean? When I plug it in, well, you know what the answer is going to be, because you already know what the rate is. When I plug it into Fano's inequality using this proof, n is bigger than or equal to the minimum distance between any two of these guys, which is this. When I put in the choice of M, you get, you think. So more generally, if we'd done it in d dimensions, it would be this. I hope I didn't rush that last part too much, but I didn't get bogged down into details about doing integrals. It's the strategy that's important. Pick a function, do a bunch of perturbations, prune it, compute the KL distance. That's sort of the whole algorithm for computing minimax lower bounds. And that's why throughout the whole course, you keep seeing things like this. And as far as the upper bound goes, well, you've seen throughout the course, we talked when Ryan did his stuff, and we talked about nonparametric regression, there are estimators that achieve this rate. So that gives you the upper bound, too. And so now we know why the minimax risk I got this right, 2 beta. Is it 2 beta? Yeah, good. And very similar things apply for density estimation and so on. Almost always now, if you look through statistics papers where they prove minimax bounds, or now NIPS papers where there's, you know, 15 years ago you didn't see many minimax bounds in NIPS. Now NIPS papers are full of minimax bounds. They almost all use some sort of strategy like this. Reduce it to a finite set and carefully choose that finite set. Once you have it down to a finite set, you're really just computing the distance between the objects of interest and something like the KL distance between those things. And you have your answer. I don't want to make it seem easier than it necessarily is, though, because yes, these calculations could be, you know, tricky in some situations. So suppose I compute the minimax bound, and so here's a good, let's do an example of that. Let's suppose you were the first guy to do density estimation, right? Nobody had ever done it before. So you come up with this brilliant idea, which is histograms. And you work out the risk, and you say it's 1 over n to the 2/3. Now you think I better compute that minimax lower bound. So you compute the lower bound, what do you get? You get 1 over n to the 4/5. And you go, uh-oh, my estimator looks a bit slow. Now I'm trying to think, in doing that calculation, would I ever have thought of doing kernel density estimation? It's not obvious to me that it would. Maybe there's cases where it would suggest an estimator, but it's not necessarily obvious that it would. In fact, you know, probably not, because otherwise we'd never have cases where we have a gap between the upper bound and the lower bound.
It's maybe also worth pointing out that the lower bound just could be loose because you've been sloppy, or maybe you don't have.
Right. So again, it's the problem is you don't know if you don't have a good estimator or your lower bound was loose. Until you've matched them, you really don't know which one it is. If I hadn't chosen a good set of distributions here, you know, I wouldn't have gotten a good bound. Okay, any other questions? I wanted to just mention a few. There's now a whole series of examples in the notes, which I'm not going to, you're not required to do them, And I'm not going to go through them in detail in class. I just wanted to have them there so you could see examples. I just want to mention a few of them that I think are kind of interesting. So I'll just pick a few that I think are kind of interesting. I should say that, you know, until you've actually computed a minimax bound, it probably all seems a little bit vague. But, you know, when you actually do one, they're all kind of, you know, 95% of them are pretty much the same. So if you really, you know, want to see how to do it, just take that example I just did and just redo the calculations yourself. They're all there for you anyway. And, you know, once you've seen one, you've kind of seen most of them. All right, so here's a few other examples, though, I want to mention, which is there really is a difference. Oh, let's skip that. That's not interesting. All right, so example 9.1 was parametric inference. Maybe I won't talk about it, but, you know, most in squared error loss, most parametric problems, the minimax rate is 1 over n. And actually, there are exceptions. In fact, I think in the homework, I put in one that had a faster rate. But most of them turn out to be 1 over n, but there are a few exceptions. But notice, though, the rates we're always talking about are slower than that. This is slower than 1 over n, and that's because we're doing it non-parametrically. Okay, so that's what example 9.1 was just mentioning there. 9.2 is if you want to see it done, just for variety, I threw in the calculations for density estimation. And just for fun, I picked a different loss function. I said, what if it was Hellinger loss you were interested in? Okay, and so I just threw that in there so you could see how you do it for different loss functions and different things. But you're gonna, if you look through it, you'll see the strategy is exactly the same. I started with a uniform density. I started adding little wiggles. I pruned it. I computed the KL distance. And, you know, we get back the same rate as we got in regression. Okay, so you can look at that if you're interested. Um, 9.3 has an interesting thing, which is, well, how about, I haven't said anything about classification. Now, Ryan mentioned that there are some results that say that under certain conditions, classification error has the same rates as regression error. Okay. However, there are, if you add extra assumptions, then there's exceptions. So remember the result was something like that the risk of a classifier minus the, let's say the Bayes risk was something like the square root, was it, of the risk for the regression problem, which I'll call RM. However, it really is less than or equal to, and under extra conditions, you actually can get it to be strictly less than. And this was proved in a minimax context. I think the first one to prove it was Sibikoff. And this is equation 40. I just want to tell you what it says, which is, and let me back up a bit. Regression in high dimensions is really hard. Classification in high dimensions doesn't seem so hard. We do high-dimensional classification all the time, right? Images, things like that, works really well. So what's the explanation for that? Well, one possible explanation, and this may not be the only explanation, one possible explanation is what's called the Sibikov low noise condition, which is suppose that we look at the regression function, which in, you know, in the binary case is the probability y equals 1 given x. We know what the Bayes classifier is. It's to classify 1 or 0 according to whether, you know, you're above half or lower than a half. But we can, you know, estimate the regression function very poorly. Here's a really bad estimator. That will have a high L2 error. But the classification risk is going to be very good because as long as you're on the correct side of the decision boundary. So which are the troublesome cases? There's two ways you can run into trouble. Suppose there was a lot of probability here, right at the boundary. Then you better be estimating the regression function very accurately there. Or if this was very, it crossed the boundary over a long period of time, right? If there's a lot of, in other words, if there's a high probability of being near the boundary, you could have trouble. But if there's small probability, that should help you. And so that's usually expressed this way, that the probability that a randomly drawn X, so I draw X and I compute M, what's the probability that I'm close to a half? And the Sibikov condition is that this is less than or equal to T to the alpha for some alpha. Okay, and so in particular, if there's very little probability near the decision boundaries, then alpha would be large. That's called the low noise condition, or the Sibikov condition. So what Sibikov did is he reworked the minimax theory for the classification error under that condition. And here's what you get. You get a different rate than anything we've seen before in class. It looks like this. Beta is the usual smoothness kind of conditions. But now we have this alpha showing up. Let's ask ourselves the following question. What happens when you have a kind of easy classification problem, meaning alpha is going to be really big? What's going to happen to this rate when alpha gets big? When alpha goes to infinity. Oh, I'm sorry. This is not beta. This is, there's another parameter row I didn't tell you about, which implicitly has something with a dimension in it. But what happens when alpha gets big here to this exponent? Yeah, this goes to 1 over n, independent of dimension. So this is just proposed as a theoretical explanation of why, even in high dimensional cases, we can get low risk for classification. And again, I'm not saying it's the only possible explanation. Oh, you're right. Something's wrong. So I've got a mistake in here. Sorry. I didn't tell you what rho was. I shouldn't have written it this way. There's another way you can write this risk that where the dimension comes into it explicitly. I did it in terms of this thing rho, which I think relates to the complexity of the decision boundary. I shouldn't have done it that way because the low noise corresponds to alpha going to infinity and rho getting small. It was an unfortunate choice of way of that I wrote it. I'm sorry about that. Anyway, the big picture here is that if you have other things like maybe there's a low noise condition, then you need to redo the minimax calculations. They have to be done differently. There's a better paper, I should have said. There's a paper by, I think it's Kryzak. I'm probably not spelling that correctly. And there's a bunch of dots and symbols scattered around. And I forget who maybe Gyorfi? Maybe. That do this more, that have probably a cleaner calculation that does it explicitly just in terms of alpha and D. And then they show you that all the things you know, nearest neighbor classification, kernel classification, automatically adapt to this low noise condition. So what this is showing you is that if there's a low noise condition, the minimax rate's better, and you don't have to do anything. The things you already use automatically should adapt to it. So I'm sorry that I don't have the, Walker maybe, or something like that. Some combination of names within a standard error of those names that are put there. So that's I just wanted to give you an example of where the minimax stuff becomes less obvious. Some other ones are 9.4 gives you some results about estimating large covariance matrices, which is of some interest. 9.5 talks about semi-supervised prediction, which maybe we could do as an advanced topic later. The reason why I mentioned the semi-supervised example is because of that table on page 17, which I think is pretty cool. I mentioned semi-supervised learning on Tuesday, let me just tell you again what it is. So you have x and y. Then you have all of this extra data on the x's and no y's. And without any assumptions at all, there is no way these data, these x's, help you do prediction. You need some extra condition. Why? Because prediction is all about, in some sense, p of y given x. What the semi-supervised data give you, the unlabeled data, is you're estimating, it allows you to estimate p of x. You need some assumption linking, at least intuitively, linking p of x to p of y given x in order to benefit from having this unlabeled data. And for a long time, there was a lot of papers about it, but not much clarity about what was going on. And I just cited this paper for you by Artie Singh in the ML department, and Rob Nowak and Jerry Zhu, which did a very, very careful analysis of semi-supervised learning from the Minimax point of view. And they made some very particular assumptions. They assumed the data fall into clusters, and they asked things about how close the clusters were and so on. And what they were able to answer was, what is the Minimax rate from labeled data, if you only get to use labeled data, and if you get to use semi-supervised regression, and does semi-supervised actually help? And I put the table there. But the point here is that it depends. You can easily construct situations. You'll see where the semi-supervised upper bound and the semi-supervised lower bound, one is better than the other one. So in some sense, the answer is it depends on the situation. Sometimes labeled data will help you. Sometimes they actually don't help you. But they were the first ones, I think, to try to make it precise using Minimax theory. And to me, that's one of the benefits of doing Minimax theory, is it sort of clarifies that you need some kinds of assumptions in order to make a claim like your semi-supervised method is actually going to work, and when is it going to work, and so on. Here's one that I mentioned in 705. You may have forgotten it by now, but I just like to mention this one just because it shows you, again, some of the unexpected things that happen. I think I mentioned it briefly in 705, but let me just mention it. This is example 9.7. It just shows you that sometimes these Minimax results are very non-intuitive, but very informative. Suppose I give you y1 to yn from some one-dimensional density, two smooth derivatives. Okay. So what do we know? We know that the Minimax rate is 1 over n to the 4/5. Yes. And kernel density estimator works. Easy, right? But now suppose the data are measured with error. You don't get to observe the y's. Sorry, these are x's. Let me stick to the notation in the note. These are x's. P is the density of the x's. Unfortunately, everyone is measured with a little bit of error. So what you observe is yi equals xi plus epsilon I. Epsilon I here is normal, random variable. And this is unobserved, but you still want to estimate the density of x. Okay, so can you do that? There are methods for estimating the density. In this case, they're called deconvolution methods. It's not the standard thing that we learned. But here's the interesting thing. What is the Minimax rate? The Minimax rate, this is a sharp lower bound, is logarithmic. We went from polynomial to logarithmic just by adding a little bit of normal noise. And if you've never seen that before, I think that's kind of shocking. It's very surprising. It's the same with regression. If you want to know the regression function between y and x, but you don't get to observe x, you observe x with error, you get logarithmic rates. And what does logarithmic rate mean? Hopeless. That's basically a constant. You know, in my world, logarithms are constants. But this is going to zero so slowly that you can't estimate the density, at least not in the usual sense. And same with the regression function. So that's, to me, that's just a great example of how when people first started doing deconvolution, they were getting logarithmic rates. And they were saying, hey, wait, maybe we're doing something wrong. We should be able to do much better than that. And then when somebody showed, no, the lower bound is logarithmic, you just know there's no point in wasting your career trying to find a better estimator. This is just intrinsic to the problem. So it's a great example of Minimax theory to the rescue, even if you don't like the answer. All right. going to skip normal means. You can read through this if you're interested. I mentioned briefly adaptive minimax theory, which is suppose I believe that the density is beta smooth, but beta is unknown. Can you construct estimators that achieve the minimax rate without knowing beta ahead of time? And the answer is yes. In principle, there are. They're called adaptive minimax estimators. So that's mentioned very briefly here, but we're going to go into the details there. Okay. And I know I'm rushing through here. Any questions about anything? Okay. The last thing, which I do want to spend a little bit of time on, actually, never covered this in this class before, but I think it's kind of interesting. All right, which is minimax hypothesis testing. So it turns out that the minimax theory for hypothesis testing is a little bit different than it is for estimation. And so for example, let me give you a very relevant example. This has been getting a lot of attention lately. I observe y1 to yn, each yi is a multinomial draw. So in other words, it takes on a discrete number of values. But we're thinking here, you know, in the olden days, again, we would typically think of the number of categories, d is pretty small and n is getting large. But in a lot of modern stuff, we want d to be pretty large. You know, in other words, a sparse multinomial. Many of the categories could have zero counts, for example. And so this has been getting a lot of renewed interest. And here's two interesting questions. So p is a vector, the probability vector. It's really p of 1 down to p of d. So it's a d-dimensional vector. And let's consider two different problems. How well can I estimate p? So if I was doing, let's think about squared error loss. Let's see how good your intuition is. Suppose I just want to compute the expected value of p hat minus p squared. In other words, the expected value of p j hat minus p of j squared. Any guesses what the minimax rate would be? Well, let's start with 1. Let's suppose I was just doing a binomial. I mean, a binomial is really 2 categories, right? But you only estimate 1 parameter because since they sum up to 1. So just think of a binomial. What's the rate at which we can estimate p hat, or p? You all know the answer. Come on. 1 over n, right? Now, any guesses of what this would be? What's the minimax rate for this?
Maybe 1 over n to the d.
1 over n to the d. Interesting. So you think it gets easier?
No, I mean 1 over n to 1 over d. It gets harder.
It gets harder, yeah. That's one guess. That's the really pessimistic guess. But that's a good guess. Any other guesses? Well, think of the risk as a sum. Each one's like 1 over n. D over n. It turns out it's d over n. And so if I hadn't squared this, it turns out it's square root of that, square root of d over n. This is typical of a parametric family with d parameters, is that the risk in squared error is d over n, or in absolute errors, or like L2 error without the square, is like the square root of that, square root of d over n. And it's basically just saying each parameter you can estimate at rate 1 over n, and there's d parameters, so it's going to be like d over n. But now here's an interesting thing. Suppose I want to do a hypothesis test. I want to test whether p is equal to some particular p0. versus p is not equal to p0. And now we end up with the kind of some interesting questions, which is, what do we mean by minimax hypothesis testing? Well, I could imagine take every possible type, every possible test with error level type 1 error. And I can now ask the following question. We're really on a simplex here. Here's some sort of neighborhood. And I can ask, what is the smallest I can make the neighborhood and still have power everywhere outside here going to 1? That's the minimax testing rate. And the neighborhood I'm going to take to be total variation distance. So I want to look at the set of p's, total variation distance between p and p0 to be bigger than epsilon. Why total variation distance? Well, we're dealing with probabilities. And total variation distance has a very probabilistic meaning. You know, if total variation distance is epsilon, then we know two things differ. The probability of any event differs by epsilon at most. L2 error wouldn't, a lot of people use L2 error in this problem, but it's not so meaningful because what's, if I tell you the L2 distance between two multinomials is 17, you know, what does that mean? It's not so interpretable. So the focus lately has been on total variation distance. And so the question people are asking was, what's the smallest epsilon such that I can test this with some non-trivial power? And you might guess it would be the same, but it's not. It's p to the 1/4 over root n. Isn't that interesting? So which one's better, the estimation rate or the testing rate? Testing rate, right? It's saying that testing is easier than estimation. And in particular, you know, this will go to 0 as long as d is less than something like, what, n squared. So you can have d almost as big as n squared. You can have way more categories than data points, so most of them will be empty, and still test this null hypothesis, which is pretty surprising. A very great question. So if testing is easier than estimation, couldn't I turn the test somehow into an estimate and then get a contradiction? It's kind of subtle, but the answer is no. I mean, you could invert this and get a confidence set, for example, and then take the center of the confidence set. It just doesn't work. I mean, we know mathematically it can't work, and it's a good observation, but it just doesn't work out. It really is particular to you're testing a particular null hypothesis. In fact, I'll tell you something else that's been discovered just in the last year or so, which is that the minimax rate is actually inhomogeneous. It depends on the null hypothesis. So I should really be writing epsilon n of p0. Some p0s, some nulls are much easier to test than others. In fact, if you're near the edges of the simplex, the rate gets really good. You can really test those easily. Why? Well, the middle is the uniform. And the uniform, it's very hard to test because even under the null, they're just going to be scattered all over the place, and then you're going to have a lot of empty cells. When you're near the edge of a simplex, the multinomial looks like this. So in some sense, the effect of dimensionality is much small, right? We're not going to see much of what's going on here. All the action is going to be kind of in a smaller set. And so maybe it seems reasonable that you'd have a better chance of having high power there. And that's exactly what happens. You get much higher power for these kinds of guys. OK, so we call this in statistics, we call this local minimax rates. In computer science, where they've got interested in this, they call it instance optimality. And here's the bizarre thing. I'm now going to tell you, what is the optimal test that achieves this? So here it is. Ready? I'm going to take the data. I'm now going to convert it into counts. C1 is how many yi's, the number of yi's, equal to 1. C2 is the number of yi's equal to 2, and so on. And if I now say, what test statistic do you think is going to work well? Every statistics student in this class, I should ask you guys, what would you put? What would you guys, without any, you know, give me a test statistic. Well, that's a way, that's, okay, permutation is the way to get the cutoff. That's correct. That's the correct way to get the cutoff. But what test statistic should I use? Come on, Robin. You know, we've rammed this into your heads. The chi-squared test, right? That's what you're all thinking. They're laughing. If we had brainwashed them enough, they would have said, well, you take the count minus the expected count, say CJ minus the expected count, squared over the expected count. This is what we teach in all of our statistics classes. You have discrete data, you want to test the hypothesis, you do the chi-squared test. You take the counts minus their expected value, squared over the expected value. This test is not minimax. It's not even close. It has terrible power. Okay. So now I'm going to tell you the secret to life. Here you go. The correct test is you take the chi-squared test, you subtract off the counts, and now watch this. Let's get rid of the n. That doesn't matter. You divide this by 2/3. Is that bizarre? And this is the minimax test. It's the locally minimax test. And in fact, if you do simulations with it, it just kills the chi-squared test in terms of power. So the reason, yeah? Well, there's no dimension here, right? This is discrete data. These are just categories. So the point of all this is to show you again that by doing a minimax investigation, completely unexpected finding. Nobody ever thought of a statistic like this before, I promise you. And it actually works in practice much better. Yeah?
So is this what we should always use for like contingency table tests?
Well, not quite, because so far I've been doing a very special case of a fixed null with a single distribution. Now, if I wanted to test whether two discrete random variables were independent, that's a, so now we're talking about you're on the simplex, and there's like a whole set of distributions, and I'm not going to have time to get to that. There's a different test for that. But yes, there are tests better than the standard ones that are in the textbook. They have just been discovered like in the last couple of years. Now, we have a strategy distance. So I happen to think, as you can tell, this is pretty cool, because I think this is, you know, amazing that you think by 2017 we'd know everything there is to know about discrete data and multinomials, and we're still finding out new things about them. And it's all through this minimax theory. So what I was originally planning to do was to now go through how do you prove upper and lower bounds for minimax hypothesis testing. But I really think that's not going to work. We've got 12 minutes left, and it's pretty long. As usual, I've miscalculated how long it takes to go through things. And you're probably getting sick of all these minimax calculations anyway, right? How much can you really take? So, yeah, so I think what's going to happen is I'm not going to go through it. I'll just quickly tell you, though, what the strategy is, which is, and then if you are interested, you don't need to know this stuff to do the assignments, but if you're interested, you can just, I've laid it out in a fair amount of detail, so it should be pretty easy to follow. But I just want to tell you what the strategy is, because it's a little bit different than estimation. And what you do is the following thing. So you take your null, and remember, we're looking at the power against all things a certain distance epsilon away. So we're interested in the power over here. And roughly speaking, what the construction does, it's kind of similar to Fanno's inequality, but it's a little bit different. We pick, again, a finite, sometimes actually infinite, set of alternatives that are all in the alternative space, but all as close as possible, that are epsilon away. Then what you do is you take these distributions, and you form a mixture. You form a new distribution. And what effectively that does is that creates a simple versus simple problem. It's now Q versus P0. This is the mixture, which we know what's the optimal test, the Neyman-Pearson test. And to bound that power, it's here on the page, turns out essentially to correspond to you'll see if you look through it, really corresponds to computing essentially what amounts to the chi-squared distance between these two measures. Okay, so the calculations are a little bit different than we did for, and what I've done here is, you know, page 21, 22 just lays out the general theory. It's all there in a page and a half, so it's not very difficult. And then I actually have worked through for you the multinomial case in gory detail, if you want to see it, in 22 and 23. And on page 24, I do the continuous version for you. And that this is relevant since we spent time. Remember we talked about two-sample testing, and I said those reproducing kernel Hilbert space tests are bogus because they claim to be dimension independent and all of this stuff. This explains why. So what I've done for you there is consider just even the one sample problem of testing that a density is equal to F0 versus being a certain distance epsilon away. I've worked out the minimax power for you, and it's this. Notice how similar this looks to the estimation rate, but it's not quite the same, right? It has a slightly different form. That's the minimax radius. Any distribution farther from the null than this, you have power against, and anything closer from this, you don't have power against. But the important thing to notice is there is a D in there. So what that's telling you is those reproducing kernel Hilbert space tests cannot be minimax. They're ignoring the dimension. At least not minimax in the usual function classes, at least. And so that was sort of my goal, was to work back to that, because I had made that as a comment when we talked about two-sample testing. I shouldn't say the tests are bogus. I mean, that's not true. The tests could be quite good. I just meant the claims that somehow they're getting around the curse of dimensionality. They're doing it because they're not being minimax against the, say, a total variation alternative to the null hypothesis. So they're giving up power somewhere. Well, that was a real whirlwind, right? We did so much today. It's amazing. We finished up Lacan. You know, we did a whole course in minimax theory in two classes. So what I know you could easily feel overwhelmed by this. So let me try to give you the takeaway messages. And obviously, if you want to know more details, there's so much more you could read about this. But the big picture is, if you're doing an estimation problem or prediction problem, the easy way to get a minimax lower and upper bound is to use Lacombe's method. We'll give you a lower bound quite easily. Your upper bound you get by just trying out your favorite estimator or classifier, whatever it is. If they match, write your paper, go home, have a beer. Okay. If you're doing an L2 or LP distance, you probably can just substitute Fano's inequality for Lacombe's inequality. And if they match, again, you're done. Now, if they don't match, you've got a research problem to deal with. Okay, so it might be sort of tricky. Okay, and then the last thing is that this minimax hypothesis testing, which sort of received much less attention overall, I think, over the years, but has had this renewed interest lately, which shows that in many cases, testing is sort of easier in some sense than estimation, but you're answering a very specific question. You're saying, did this generate the data, yes or no, which is a bit different than saying, how well can I estimate some parameter? Okay. So in the homework, you're going to see, you'll have to do some question, I think, with Lacombe's, not a very just direct application. It's nothing tricky. It's not some complicated application of that stuff. For this class, you know, obviously don't expect you to become experts in minimax theory. Just understand basically what Lacombe's lemma is saying. Okay, any questions about all of this stuff? All right, plan. That will conclude then the minimax theory. Next week, Ryan's going to start doing sparsity, right? So we'll start doing, by the way, that one other thing I wanted to mention quickly. There is an example in here. What happened to that example? If I had had time. So you might want to look at example 10 on page 8. It's only 5 lines long, and it's a sparsity example. It just computes, it shows you how to compute the minimax rate taking into account sparsity in the many normal means problem. I have a bunch of means. You get an observation on each one, and I tell you it's sparse. I only do the really sparse case. I tell you one of the thetas is not zero and the rest are all zero. What is the minimax rate? And that example 10 just computes it using basically something like Lacombe's lemma and using the chi-squared distance. So remember I said sometimes it's more convenient to bound things with the chi-squared instead of the KL. This is an example where bounding it with the chi-squared just turns out to be easy. So there's another example I forgot to mention that's germane because since Ryan's going to be talking about sparsity next week. Last thing is some of you did not pick up your tests. So if you did, all right. If you didn't, on the way out, you might want to stop by here. I think they're, are they in alphabetical order?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're in alphabetical order, and they're right there. All right, we'll see you next week.